All right, so the title of the talk is the brain state dependent coordination of neurons in memory circuits. And what I mean by brain states, well, at the grossest level, we have waking states and waking and sleep. And it's pretty intuitive what waking is good for. You still prefer them? Okay. Because there's some fans up there. I just feel like it's hard to get the optimal distance with the mic, so it gets loud and quiet. Right, so with waking, you know, it's clear what the benefits are. We get to experience life, and we need to find food, figure out how to get back to where that food was. And if all goes well, there's mating involved. And reproduction. On the other hand, the purposes of sleep are a little bit more elusive. Some functions that have been attributed to sleep, though, are we save some energy by resting. The brain removes toxins during sleep. It's a good time to synthesize some proteins that might be important for learning and memory. And there's a restorative effect, not only on the body, but also on your brain cells. The experiments that we do in my lab involve electrophysiology, so we implant arrays of electrodes. Oh, sorry, I forgot two little aspects of this was that, you know, within sleep there's also microstates, REM and non-REM during sleep, which Hiroyuki will talk about after mine. But also a little bit less appreciated is that during waking itself, there's different active and resting states that the brain transitions through. And I'll be talking about mostly those during my talk. So we implant electrode arrays, silicon probes that now you're using here, I understand. So we implant arrays of these in the hippocampus. Most of the data I'm gonna be talking to you is from the hippocampus of rats. And so this is a sample 2-second recording that Hiro obtained. And so you can see, so the different colors are different groups of electrodes. So this is multiple shanks. These are 6 shanks. Each shank has 8 channels on it. And you can see, essentially, these are so local. These are, you know, these ones are about 20 microns apart each, and then each of these are about 200 microns from each other. So when I say brain states, you can see that the patterns of activity are highly different from the second over here and this first second on the left. So over here on the right side, you can see common to all the electrodes, there's a prominent oscillation. If you count the number of peaks on there, you'll see that it's an 8 hertz oscillation. That 8 hertz oscillation is called theta, and we see it usually when the animal is actively engaging in a task. And Adriano spoke about this last evening, yesterday. Now on the left-hand side, the activity is remarkably different, right? So you can see that the neuronal activity is definitely brain state dependent. And over here, the activity is very irregular, but your attention is probably drawn to this brief oscillatory event that's common to all the electrodes. This is the sharp wave ripple oscillation. We see it when the animal is resting or obtaining a reward. And there you can see there's large spiking activity that's happening at the same time. This overall event lasts somewhere between 50 and 400 milliseconds. There's an oscillation in around 180 to 200. 250 hertz, and there's large spiking activity that happens at the same time. So so essentially you can see what I mean about brain state dependent, and you get a sense of the type of data that we're talking about as well. All right. Now, it's important to bring a note that we record in the hippocampus, and the hippocampus is considered to have an important role in, well, it's been known to have an important role in memory formation. How it carries out that role is still debated, but what's generally accepted is that when we have a new experience, that hippocampal neurons are able to, there's large synaptic plasticity in the hippocampus, so connections between hippocampal neurons modify very quickly. This part is a bit more controversial, but presumably over time there's some transfer of this learning that happens in the hippocampus to neocortical modules, so connections between different neocortical brain regions might be modified as well to encode some aspects of that memory. And so the hippocampus, the systems consolidation view of the hippocampal function is that over time it's the fast learner of the brain, and over time it teaches the neocortex the important aspects of the experience that should be encoded. Now, are you guys familiar with this year's Nobel Prize in Physiology? You know that the winner was John O'Keefe. Does anybody know what he won the Nobel Prize for? Hippocampus, in particular he won it for his discovery of place cells in the hippocampus, right? So, what do we mean by place cells? How many people have seen a place cell movie before? All right, so about half. That's a healthy fraction. For some of you who haven't, and nobody gets tired of the place cell movie anyway. So here's a recording done by my colleague David Rogue when he was in the Bujaki lab. So I'm going to play you a video, and the rat has an LED on his head. This is a tethering cable, so you can ignore that. But just pay attention to the animal's position, and on the audio, you can hear spiking from a single neuron in the hippocampus. So you can see that's the spiking of that cell, and you can pay attention to when the spiking is occurring. And it becomes hopefully clear after a few trials why these were called place cells. They fire robustly in this particular part of the environment. And then if you also pay a little attention, you can hear the rhythmicity of the cell as well. So that's that 8 hertz oscillation is the theta that I mentioned earlier that happens when the animal is actively engaged in the task. And John O'Keefe and others did a large number of experiments over time to really establish that indeed it's the location or place that these neurons are encoding, not some particular specific cues in the environment. Okay, so that's the timing relative. So the title of my talk was coordination among neurons. So I guess the outline of this talk is I'm going to talk about coordination relative to different things that we can look for. So that's the pedagogical aspect of the talk, is you can look at coordination of spiking relative to different types of measurements. So one is with the place cells, you look at the timing of spiking relative to the animal's position in an environment. And now we can also look at the timing of spiking relative to the local field potential, so the theta oscillation that's going on during exploration. And when you draw the LFP, there's the 8 hertz oscillation, and we can basically look at the filtered LFP and look at when the spikes occur relative to the phase of the oscillation. So as the rat runs through a place cell, this is an animation courtesy of Mikhail Zugarow at Collège de France. As the animal runs through a place cell, there's spiking that occurs. That's the place cell. That's the place field. Now, as the animal is also running through, we have an ongoing theta oscillation. And now we can look at where the spiking occurs relative to the theta oscillation. So for each of the groups of spikes, we can take the average phase. And the phase, if we refer to the peak at 0 and the trough at 180, we can look at basically measure that. And the remarkable thing in the hippocampus is that we see that the phase is changing as the animal moves through the place field, and that it advances every single cycle. So if we look at the, basically from the spiking earlier on is happening near the peak of theta, and as the animal moves, so it starts at 360, and then you can see it shifts to earlier and earlier. By this point, the cell is firing at the trough of the theta oscillation. So this phenomenon is called theta phase precession. It was also discovered by John O'Keefe, and it's quite robust. We see it in essentially all of the place cells that we record from, and it provides another additional source of information about where precisely the animal is within its place field. So you can look at essentially the phase of firing relative to the theta, and you know among this place field where the animal happens to be. Is that clear? Yep.
If he stays at one position, it's going to keep at the phase of that position?
It will. So it becomes a little bit tricky because if the animal's not moving, you lose the theta oscillation, so the state changes. So how well you're able to define the theta phase, that you lose that. But it does not depend on speed, which I think is what you're getting to. So if he moves very quickly or very slowly, you see the same phase at a given position. So in that sense, it's whereas like the firing rate is also speed dependent. So there's been some argument that the theta phase gives you a more accurate decoder of location than firing rate alone for a given cell, for a given place field. Okay, so that's the firing relative to the LFP. So what if we look at the spiking of cells relative to each other? So what's a useful measure of that, which I encourage you to use in your analysis, is the cross-correlogram. Nothing complicated. So the cross-correlogram, essentially we keep, we look at spike timing, and for each time, so we're looking at two cells. One of them is going to be shown in green and the other one in red. Excuse me. And for the spiking of, so every time our reference cell spikes, we look at see when the second cell spikes. And we look at basically time lags, and we bin the time. And every time we get a spiking that corresponds to a certain time lag, we add a count to that. So essentially, if there's no timing relationship with between two cells, you would expect that the cross-correlogram will be essentially flat, right? The timing between the two cells should be random, probably. So here's a run as the animal runs through the place field, and you saw the first cell is green and then a second cell red. And now we're keeping track of the timing relations between those two across trials. So this is the cross-correlogram, as you can see. So, you know, if I have, and you can see over time that basically there is some timing relationships between the cell pairs that's revealed. It's not random. This isn't flat, but that, you know, cell B seems to fire more likely than expected at with certain time lags that are repeating, and that repetition is the theta oscillation. Is that clear? So this isn't entirely surprising if you keep in mind theta phase precession that I mentioned earlier. If we look at these two cells, each of them shows phase precession, so the blue cell will fire earlier and earlier, and so does the green cell. And if you look at their timing between each other, that's not entirely random. There's some time lags that are more likely, and these become evident over time. So if we look at all of our cell pairs, we can look at the relationship between the time lag between cells and then the distance in the difference in the locations at which they encode, and that relationship is sigmoidal. So essentially cells that are encode locations farther away from each other will have a larger time lag in the peak of the cross-correlograms. Cells that encode locations a little bit closer to one another, their peak will be closer to zero, and so on. And the reason it's sigmoidal is because we're looking at large numbers of cells, so some of the cells have very small place field. If we look at just the small place fields, we see that the slope would be about 3 milliseconds per centimeter. If we look at the large place fields, those will have a different slope. And but essentially, because we're limited by the theta cycle, so we can only, we look at peaks only one theta cycle away, we have a limit, and that creates the sigmoidal aspect of it. So there's essentially a peak that we can't go beyond in time. All right, so that's the timing of cells relative to each other at the time scale of theta. Now we can look at, instead of looking at pairs of neurons, we can look at the entire population at the same time. And right now I'm not going to do any really sophisticated analysis of that population activity. I hope that's maybe something Caleb Kamara is going to talk about tomorrow, or perhaps, right? Yeah, so of course it becomes complicated how to decode the information since we're recording from large populations of neurons. But if we just look at the spike rasters alone, well, we can arrange for, since we have a population of place cells, now we can arrange those cells according to their place field. So in this case, we're looking at some 13 place fields, and I've just ordered them. These are place fields on a linear track, so the animals, and in one direction, the animals running from left to right. And so we have a number of place cells and place fields, and we can just arrange those relative to the preferred firing location of those cells. So we can basically map out a sequence of place fields that the animal is going to experience during a given run, right? And as a consequence of the theta phase precession, if you look at any given theta cycle, these cells are phase precessing. So for example, let's look at this first blue cell. It'll start firing near the peak of theta, and that phase will advance as the animal moves through this environment, so that, you know, the firing will be maximal near the trough and so forth. And the consequence of that, when you look at the population activity, is when the rat is in this particular location during a given theta cycle, you know, the first cell that's going to fire is going to be this neuron, the blue neuron, and then later on you'll get firing of the cyan, and later on the firing of the brown. So there'll be a sequence of cells that even at this particular location that's firing, which is a sequence of the place fields in front of the animal, right? And that's during the theta oscillation. And by the time the animal gets a little bit further along, that sequence will be of a different group of neurons. Now, because of theta phase precession, cells, this cell that encoded the location earlier will still fire first, and there'll be a sweep from locations encoded behind the animal to locations in front of the animal. And David Reddish's group and some other groups have done a lot of research on that. I'm not going to go into that too much, but I just wanted to touch upon it, is that you get some sequences of activity during any given theta cycle when the animal is running along. Is that clear, someone? Okay, so let's look at the entire raster for one given trial. So this is one trial where the animal is running from left to right on that track, and I've colored those the spike raster. So each of these dashes is the spiking for each of the rows, corresponds to a different neuron, which is colored relative, corresponding to its place field. And you can somewhat see those theta, and on the top, actually, I'm showing the local field potential, so you can see this regular theta pattern, this fast oscillation becomes somewhat visually easier to see, that's the theta oscillation, and then the activity is more regular before and after the run. So his velocity is here. You can see that the animal starts off at rest on the left side, and then he runs across, and then he's resting again on the other side of the track. So naturally, what should be evident is the sequence of place fields that he runs through, right? So there's that behavioral sequence. Of course, I've encoded it that way. The animal's running through these 13 or 14 different place fields, and on the order of from basically in about 5 seconds, you see the firing of all these different neurons, right? So that's the sequence of of place cells, that's the experiential place field firing. And what's less evident, but if you zoom in, you can see that, you know, there are these theta sequences, some of these lines of firing you can see. So those are the theta sequences within a given theta cycle. And the other interesting thing that hopefully you'll have noticed if you look at the raster plot is what happens before and after the trial actually is during these brief windows before and after the trial running. If you zoom, there's large population activity. And if you zoom in on those and look at the timing, you'll see basically there's a, on this side, there's a forward replay or almost pre-play before he runs, but I'll call it replay because he's run through this environment multiple times, so he's experienced the track before, and he's basically replaying the environment that he's going to be running across in that sequence. So now this is not on the order of the 5 seconds in which the cells fire when he's actually running, and he's actually at rest, so this is outside of the place fields themselves. But there's that sequence is being played out, and at the same time as the sharp wave ripple oscillation that I mentioned that you see when the animal is at rest. So during that sharp wave ripple oscillation, when we saw population bursting activity, there is information in the sequence of cells relative to each other. So that, and then on the other side, after he's run through, we can see the sequential firing, but now it's in the reverse order. So this is the reverse replay of the trajectory that the animal just ran through. Is that clear? Okay, so this is, you know, without any complicated analysis, just by ordering the cells, we can see that there's basically bursts of activity and that they contain information about what, you know, that we wouldn't get by looking at single neurons alone. So by looking at the population, we see that there's replay, and that's really one of those type of activities that you can only learn about when you record a population of neurons at the same time. And these population activities are quite robust, so I just want to show you a few samples that we recorded during when the animal was resting during the sharp wave ripple. So we see robust forward replay and reverse replay. And we can, you know, we did statistical analysis on this, so these events are statistically robust. I won't go into that right now. So what's particularly exciting about the sharp wave ripples that happening during rest is that we know from other data from Yuri Buzhaki, my postdoctoral mentor, and others, that the sharp wave ripples are likely generated within the CA3 circuit. So now we look at the circuit of the hippocampus that generates these patterns. And this is a simplified hippocampal circuit where we have inputs coming from the entorhinal cortex going through either the dentate gyrus, so the more prominent pathway, the so-called trisynaptic pathway in the hippocampus is from entorhinal cortex through dentate gyrus, CA3, back to CA1, which is considered the output node of the hippocampus. It projects to layer 5 of the entorhinal cortex. But one feature that's particularly notable is this recurrent connectivity within the CA3. So CA3, region CA3 has a lot of connections within itself. And those recurrent connections are considered to be essentially the source of the sharp wave ripple oscillation. So because there's a lot of connections within CA3 when it's not being driven externally by entorhinal cortex, that the seed of activity can essentially get carried away into a burst, and perhaps in, you know, abnormal conditions it can be a source of epileptic seizures, right? Because there's a lot of connections within itself. So when a little bit of activity will quickly sort of avalanche into the ripple oscillation, and that generates the ripple itself isn't seen in CA3, but it's seen in CA1, subiculum, entorhinal cortex. So that oscillatory event then propagates out of the hippocampus. So it started in the hippocampus, and it propagates out of the hippocampus rather faithfully. And because it's a population event, there's a large amount of activity, and that's if you have a large population activity that basically might be strong enough to propagate out of the hippocampus. Which is pretty interesting when you get back to the ideas about, you know, what one of the functions of the hippocampus. It's supposed to be teach the rest of the brain, as I mentioned earlier, what it has learned, what's the important aspects of the information it's gained on a given trial. So now if you have a population event during the sharp wave ripple that can leave the hippocampus and spread to neocortical regions, perhaps this can create the conditions for spike timing dependent plasticity in other circuits as well. So it's exciting also because now we also see there's a replay during the sharp wave ripples. So we see that there's information during the sharp wave ripples, and then if this is the kind of faithful information that would be important for other brain regions to learn. For example, what was the sequence of places we went through to get to where the reward was. And some data from sleep recordings has also shown there's some synchrony between the sharp wave ripples and thalamocortical spindles in neocortical brain regions. So they can be, the sharp wave ripple happens at the trough of the spindle. So there is essentially, there is coordination between hippocampus and neocortex. At least that's been seen during sleep. It remains to be seen the extent to which it's also there during waking. So that's why a lot of people have been interested in sleep as a potential stage for memory consolidation, because now you have the coordination between hippocampus and other brain regions. So it could be the time in which hippocampal dependent memories are consolidated. Well, I won't comment so much. About the pattern completion in this kind of experiment, it's probably more. What people often talk about is that the pattern completion might, for example, allow the neurons to fire in that place dependent manner, because a subset of cues might be missing, but the animal still understands where it is. So you'll get the pattern completion, and that'll be the place cell firing. So that's, essentially that the robustness of the place code is likely due to that pattern completion. So basically a subset of sensory cues is coming in from the entorhinal cortex, and then in CA3 the cells will fire in that place dependent manner robustly. But then that sequence is encoded within the CA3 circuit. And then what's interesting is now you go offline, so now the animal is no longer running through the place cells, but because of that sequence has been encoded within the synapses, at least my view of this is that a little bit of spontaneous activity will replay that sequence because those synapses have been strengthened now. And so you'll get basically a replay, at least for some time window following the experience. And then this signal can go back to the neocortex, which isn't doing the pattern completion. I mean, the neocortex is just, taking in the sensory stimuli, but now that sequence could be going back to the neocortex and perhaps encoding how to get back to that location or allowing the cortex to trigger memories of how to get back to that location. Thanks for the question. Okay, so summary so far of the talk is, I showed you about timing relative to movement allowed us to note play cell activity. We looked at timing relative to local field attack activity, and that gave us phase precession, which was another aspect of the place field code. Timing between neurons, we saw that wasn't random, that there were some reliable time lags, and that gave us information about the distances between the place fields. And by looking at the population activity, we could essentially uncover this replay phenomenon. So now I'm going to focus on timing of neurons relative to each other. So this is a kind of different gear altogether. And if we look at basically if we use cross correlograms, but look at it at a much finer time scale. So earlier we looked between, you know, 200, minus 200 and plus 200 milliseconds. Now I'm zooming in from minus 50 to plus 50. If you look at two neurons, sometimes we see these peaks in the cross correlogram at very short latency. And if you zoom in even further, you'll see that basically, in this case, this second neuron, the blue neuron, tends to fire more likely than expected by chance, about one or two milliseconds following the spiking of this, about 1 millisecond firing spiking of this pyramidal neuron, which is shown in red. If you look at the spikes, the spike waveforms, you'll see this in the, if you trigger it based on the trough of the red stuff. So basically this reliable timing of cell, so what we're gaining from this is that we see that the blue cell fires essentially very often 1 millisecond later following spiking of this reference red stuff. And this can be, well, it remains putative, but it gives you some indication that perhaps there's a connection between these cells. And I believe that from this we can infer a monosynaptic excitatory connection between this red cell and the blue cell, because it's unlikely that that any other kind of event could give you this precise timing coordination. Caleb? Yeah, I mean, it's unlikely so the only other way you could think about, and you can't rule it out logically entirely, is that common input to these two cells. So for some reason, basically input to the second cell would arrive like 1 millisecond later and the input to cell one, but that seems, you know, physiologically very unbelievable, right? It shouldn't be surprised. We oftentimes see these between pyramidal cells and interneurons that are very close to each other. And so, you know, we know that from neuroanatomy that there's going to be connections between pyramidal cells and interneurons. So it shouldn't be surprising that we can gather this information from extracellular data as well. And not only can we infer excitatory connectivity, but we can also infer inhibitory connection. So we see basically a dip in the likelihood of spiking of the second cell following spiking of the blue cell in this case. So this decreased likelihood to fire is likely due to an inhibitory connection between the blue cell and the red cell. And we can have examples of reciprocal connectivity as well, where there's an increase in firing, the blue cell following the red one, and then a decrease in the red one following the blue one. So in that case, the cross correlogram would show you this type of pattern. So this is from this peaks. I mean, these are visually identified peaks, but if we want to do a more thorough analysis, we need some statistics as well. So the best tool is for using that is by introducing jitter into the spike times. So in the example, if we have two cells, cell A and cell B, we can look at the spike timing between those two and create the cross correlogram. So for the real spike train, we might have a peak like this. And now we add jitter to the spike timing of the cell B, the second cell, 5 millisecond of spike timing, and for each of those instances, we can also, you know, evaluate the cross correlogram. In that case, this jittered cross correlogram that'll remove, adding the jitter will remove any precise timing relations between the spike trains, right? So a jittered spike train might have a cross correlogram that looks something like this. And by, you know, doing the jittering multiple times and looking at the cross correlograms, and then we can basically see how often did we get a peak this high in the jittered spike trains. So if we get, if we are likely to get, you know, some peaks, we're going to get some peaks by chance, right? So by doing the jittering multiple times, like 1,000 times, then we can look at the likelihood. We can basically create confidence bands for the peaks, and once our real data exceeds the confidence bands that we've created from the surrogate data, jittered data, then we can say, okay, I think I have a significant peak in my cross correlogram. So this is always a challenge, is, you know, you see a peak visually, you want to know, well, you know, how big of, should the peak be before I really can call it a peak? And by doing this jitter analysis, basically remove the guesswork from it, and you can base it on statistics. So using this, then, we can, in a sample recording from our from region CA3 and CA1, so this is some recordings that I did. These are each of these along the x-axis. Each of these is, I had 8 shanks in region CA3 and 4 shanks in CA1. So looking at the neurons that were recorded and the relative to the electrode number, so these are 8 electrodes per shank. So I basically put the neurons at the, based on their spike waveform at the electrode where they projected the largest amplitude spike. And from those, all of these lines, the cyan lines, are putative excitatory connections that we observe from those, between those neurons. So you can see there's a lot of excitatory connections, and they tend to be from the pyramidal cells to the interneurons. You can see essentially they almost always go in that one way. We don't see excitatory connections between the putative interneurons and the pyramidal cells. And then also in the black, I've shown you the putative inhibitory connections, and those are also from the interneurons that we recorded, putative interneurons and the pyramidal neurons. So that also, one, confirms our classification of these as inhibitory and excitatory, which I didn't get to, but if somebody has a question about that, I can describe how we do that classification. But basically, based on the autocorrelogram, the spiking timing of the cells, whether they're fast spiking or slow spiking, and then also on the waveforms of their spikes. So we can basically infer this microcircuit connectivity in this microcircuit. But what was particularly exciting that came out of this analysis was this unexpected other category of classifications that I'm now showing in red, that were between all these A3, largely between the interneurons, but also sometimes between excitatory cells and each other, as well as excitatory cells and inhibitory cells. So these red connections indicated actually peaks, not at 1 millisecond latency, but actually within the central 0 millisecond bin. So within the very central bin, plus or minus 0.5 milliseconds, timing relationships are captured there. And we saw a lot of peaks right in that central 0 millisecond bin. And, you know, again, we did the statistical analysis. So these were the ones that are statistically robust. And here's some examples from that data. And you can see, basically, we saw some unusual amount of synchrony right in that 0 millisecond bin. So basically, what we observed is that the hippocampal neurons were synchronous to each other at very fast, on a very fast time scale. And that's on a millisecond time scale. We saw it in, out of all the interneuron pairs and all the recordings that I had access to at the time, I saw it in 11.6% of those interneuron pairs. And we saw it, we had a lot more pyramidal interneuron pairs, And these occurred in a fewer percentage, only 0.39%. And even in the pyramidal-pyramidal pairs, so we had about 42,000 of those, we saw it in 60, which is 0.14. And so you might think, well, you know, you're doing the statistical analysis 42,000 times, so aren't you going to see, even by chance, even with statistics, sometimes some peaks? So to address that possibility, we did an additional analysis where we jittered all of the spike trains, so now the entire spike train by 5 milliseconds, and then repeated the entire analysis. So now we're basically removing, we're just getting a sense of how likely you are to get these just by chance in a jittered spike train. So when you jitter all of the data and then re-perform the analysis, you know, even the 60 out of 42,000 is much higher than you would expect by chance. In chance, in the jitter data, we saw pyramidal-pyramidal synchronous pairs only on average about 6 in 6 neurons out of all of those pairs. So even this 0.14% pyramidal-pyramidal interactions is statistically significant. So the next thing was we wanted to see, well, what are some possible mechanisms for this millisecond timescale synchrony? Can anybody suggest some possible mechanisms? Or why would we see such fast synchrony between neurons? What? The synapses should have a latency, right? Electrical coupling. Oh, okay, right. So gap junctions. Yeah, that was the first thing that occurred to me as well. Any other suggestion? Caleb? Common input. That's a great possibility. Any other ideas? Well, one thing might be that, I guess similar to common input, the ideas that occurred to me were, well, and it could be that, you know, we see the sharp wave ripples. That's basically a population level event. And maybe that population oscillation is creating a greater likelihood for these cells to fire at the same time than you would expect by chance. Similar to that, it might be gamma oscillation. Maybe co-modulation by gamma might create greater likelihood to fire at 0 milliseconds than by chance. And then the other ideas were common input, gap junctions, and along the lines of Clayton, actually the synaptic connections themselves, you could get post-inhibitory rebounds. So essentially it seemed like that might be another way where if multiple cells are being, you know, inhibited and then released from inhibition, the rebound might act to synchronize these cells. So these were all the ideas that we could think of. And so we went through them one by one and tried to evaluate whether they were likely or not to give us this synchrony. So first, for the sharp wave ripples, we ruled that out right away because we saw this millisecond timescale synchrony was independent of the brain state. So these were in freely moving animals, and we saw the millisecond synchrony during theta oscillations, during LIA, and during ripple. So it wasn't just during one type of network state. It wasn't just during ripples. And we saw that in 99.5% of the pairs. So we ruled out the sharp wave ripples. And for gamma, then we basically started to break down the cross-correlogram depending on the gamma phase at the time of spiking of the reference cell. So we broke it up into quadrants. And even though, you know, the CCGs were modulated by the phase of gamma, for the most part, we saw significant peaks regardless of the phase of the gamma oscillation. So to us, it suggested that it wasn't that the cells were co-modulated by gamma. You could see millisecond timescale synchrony regardless of the firing phase. Yes, Ka? In this case, I think I took quite a broad range of gamma from 30 to 90 hertz. So basically, it's a Hilbert transform of the spiking relative to the phase between 30 to 90 hertz if it was varying. Right. So the fact that we could see this regardless of the phase of gamma suggested that it wasn't co-modulation by gamma. And anyway, you don't necessarily see gamma during LIA. Well, you do to some extent, maybe, but certainly not as robustly as during theta. So for now, we rule out these two possibilities. Now, for common input, you might remember that the cells, hippocampal cells, are place dependent. So we can different place cells are active in different parts of the environment. So to address this possibility of common input from pyramidal neurons, we repeated the analysis with different spatial sectors. So I split the data into three spatial sectors for each of those cell pairs and looked at see if we see peaks at the beginning of the track, in the middle of the track, or at the end of the track. And in 86% of the pairs, the central peak was significant in all spatial sectors. So at least it suggested that a subset of place cells alone were not synchronizing these cells robustly, in that you know that different place cells are going to be active at the beginning or at the end of the track, and if you still see a peak in the CCG in both cases, at least doesn't seem to be common input from some specific pyramidal cells. It would have to be essentially a very broad overlap in their common input to account for that. Yes. Well, but the interneurons, I mean, right, so the only other possibility is, inhibition, release from inhibition, because what's driving those cells is typically pyramidal cell activity, right? So their input is excitatory, has to come from place cells, because that's all we have in the hippocampus. Okay, but I'm going to keep a question mark there, because, we haven't settled that it's not common input. So to figure out if it was gap junctions, one interesting thing about the interneuron firing is that if you look at interneurons and their firing relative to the sharp wave ripples, different neurons tend to fire very robustly to essentially all sharp wave ripples. So this is two example cells, and for example, let's look at this blue cell in this unusual recording, my electrodes got stuck. But the nice thing was I had very stable neurons for about 7 days from these neurons. So the waveforms are pretty much the same from the second day of recording and the seventh day, and similarly for this cell. I felt very confident that I was tracking these cells because it was also across a population that we see the same waveforms and same spiking over multiple days. And now looking at the ripple, at the spiking of these cells relative to ripples, this cell essentially robustly increased its firing during sharp wave ripples all the time. So from day two to day seven. And this other cell, its spiking, it seemed to increase a little bit near the onset of the ripple, and then the spiking was decreased following the onset of the ripple, and decreased a little bit extended after. Now, some little aspects of it might be a little different. It looks a little bit more spiky in this particular session. So there is indeed some variability. But some general features of this spiking response during ripples can be captured and seems to be a reliable property of those interneurons. So going through all of the interneurons, I created this sort of broad categorization, and I indicated with these different colors, essentially tried to categorize neurons according to one of these nine responses. And I'm not saying that each of those is different from each other, but certainly, this one to three type of response is very different from the responses of seven to nine. So that color code should capture some of those differences. And what's interesting is that, if you look at some of the juxtacellular recordings done by Klausberger and Shimogi in hippocampal neurons, they also found that basically different classes of interneurons seem to fire in typical manner during theta. They have some preferred firing during theta, but also some presumably reliable firing during the sharp wave ripples. Of course, they couldn't say much about reliability because juxtacellular recordings are very challenging, and so in some of these putative categories, they had two examples. So they said, okay, I had two examples of cells, OLM cells, that seem to not fire during theta, but, you know, so hopefully that's maybe a category, but if n equals 2 might not be enough. But anyway, so the basic idea is that perhaps by looking at these ripple responses, we capture some aspect of the sort of type of cell that we're recording, because interneurons, there's large amount of classifications between the cells, but it's generally considered that gap junctions are formed between cells of the same type. So gap junctions between different neuronal types are rarely seen. So now by having this classification of type, we could try to see, well, how likely are we to see millisecond time cell synchrony between cells of the same type or between cells of different types? And there's a lot on this, but the one to look at is the millisecond synchrony. So we looked at the cells that were categorized as in this perhaps putative basket cells, PV basket cells, which is classes 1 to 3, and we looked to see if those form millisecond synchrony with other cell types captured by, you know, 4 through 9. And indeed, we saw that, you know, that these cells did form millisecond synchronous pairs with cells of other cell types. So at least the millisecond synchrony was seen between cells that fired very differently during the sharp wave ripples, which is essentially the best way we have it to infer cell type extracellularly. So it's not conclusive, therefore I leave a question mark, but it seemed that gap junctions alone could not explain all of the millisecond synchrony that we saw in the data set. And that leads post-inhibitory rebound, and what was exciting about that is I found a paper by Ariel Agmon, University of Virginia, Journal of Neuroscience, 2011. In that case, this is data obtained from slices in vitro in the hippocampus, and because by recording two cells simultaneously, they were able to infer the extent to which these cells were electrically coupled or synaptically coupled. And they were surprised that they saw in cells that were purely synaptically coupled, so interneurons, fast spiking interneurons, or that they saw that essentially when they depolarized both of the cells, that after some time, the spike times aligned between those cells, even in a slice. There was no evidence for electrical coupling between those cells. This is also some evidence that you don't need gap junctions to get the millisecond synchrony. And so this is a reciprocally connected, what they called fast spiking cells, and they even saw it in monosynaptic, in directional coupling between fast spiking and SOM spike, somatostatin positive cell. And so even one directional coupling between the recorded neurons was enough to give them to generate millisecond synchronous firing between those pairs. So you can see these asterisks are when the cells start to spike at the same time. So this is not necessarily post-inhibitory rebound, but it suggests that basically inhibitory connections alone can generate synchrony between cells. Now, post-inhibitory rebound was looked at by Adhikari, Pascal, Kalikini, and some others recently in a Journal Neuroscience paper. One interesting thing is they looked specifically at post-inhibitory rebound, but that was highly state-dependent. So they saw much larger post-inhibitory rebound during, in this case, for example, in this pair, during theta, and during the slow oscillation. In some cases, they saw it in both. So in a large percentage of times, that this post-inhibitory rebound was state-dependent, which we didn't see. So then for, you know, whether there's some inhibitory rebound, I guess we think that this is most likely to be generating a lot of the synchrony that we see, but we have to leave it with a question mark. And then one other interesting aspect is we can really look at Because we have a 32,000 sampling rate in some of the recordings, we can even look at the cross-correlogram at a finer time scale. You need a lot of spike times to get any reliable peaks if you, you know, subdivide your CCG at such a fine resolution. But we still, so most of these synchronous pairs that we know that there was excess synchrony within this from 0.5 to minus 0.5 to plus 0.5 millisecond, for the most part, when you look at them, the CCGs at that fine time resolution look something like this. So it's kind of smeared across those finer timescales. But as you can see in a subset, like basically 5% of those synchronous pairs, we see some really exquisite timing. In this case, basically these cells are firing at, you know, 0.1 millisecond firing following each other. So just even the diversity of these cross-correlograms, and then in some of them you see a little bit more lag, and in a few you see basically a very sharp peak at zero followed by little dips around it. So we saw basically examples of all this, suggesting that actually there might be a diversity of mechanisms that allow this pattern to be generated. And to me, I mean, this really exquisite timing is suggestive of a gap junction. Because electrical coupling, you know, that really seems to be a precise propagation of some sort of spike from one neuron to another. So I think that basically there's probably a range of it seems like there's a range of mechanisms for generating this type of synchrony in the population, and maybe they're all active, and this gives rise to such a prevalent the kind of prevalence that we've seen. Adriana? So I guess how you know, maybe there should be some variability in our in the trough, in our ability to detect the trough. Usually, we look at the peak. We look at the trough, but yeah, so the trough of the spike, because you know, it's negative, but right. So you're right that there's going to be some variability in the wave shape. So that's going to compromise our ability to really detect the peak. I didn't look at the wave shapes, for example, in these pairs specifically. It could be that, for example, those are some of our larger amplitude interneurons. It could be that there is some wave shape that allows this. So it could be that basically maybe, you know, these are similar, but that in this case I had large amplitude waves, and maybe these aren't really different from each other. That's certainly... It seems like there's something a little bit different from here and here, but it's true. It could just be a signal detection. I think this was particularly surprising that this even gave you something like. I mean, even these little dips, you know, before and after was surprising. And these are, by the way, you know, on different Shanks electrodes. So I eliminated, obviously, you know, neurons recorded on the same. These are at least 200 microns apart from each other. So what is it good for? I think we still don't know what this milliseconds timescale synchrony might, if it has any use. But one thing that we see is that, well, you know, if more interneurons fire at the same time, this has a larger downstream inhibitory effect. So when we saw synchronous firing in CA1, and now we look at just the cross-correlogram between synchronous firing of interneurons and then the pyramidal spiking. So this is just for the pyramidal cells. We saw that following synchronous spiking, they're more likely to be inhibited than following non-synchronous spiking. So in that sense, maybe it's not surprising. A lot of interneurons fire at once. Now you get a larger inhibitory effect, and then there's a larger rebound excitatory effect from that. Going back, though, to the inhibitory story, we did see that, you know, pyramidal cells were more likely to be firing preceding the synchronous firing as well. So there did seem to be a little bit more activity across the entire pyramidal cell population. So this again did argue for some role for common input. But right, so essentially, what good is it? I think that's still an open question. Okay, so to summarize this last part, we saw this frequent millisecond timescale synchrony. It wasn't state dependent. Wasn't due to co-modulation by gamma or ripples. Probably not due to common input alone or gap junctions alone, but post-inhibitory rebound, based on the slice work, seemed likely to be a mechanism for generating it in vivo as well. So for this very last, I'll quickly talk about just some optogenetic experiments that we did in our lab, sort of touch upon that hot or semi-hot topic. So Marie Gilmartin did these experiments in my lab where she infused ArchT virus in the medial prelimbic region of the medial prefrontal cortex of rats. She injected them and then implanted optical fibers in that brain region. And we were interested in looking to see if this region played a role in an associative memory during trace sphere conditioning. So there are a large number of controls, but I'll just go to the two essential comparisons, which are basically between, so in trace sphere conditioning, what we do is there's a CS, a conditioned stimuli that's delivered, and after a 20-second interval, the animal receives a mild foot shock on the cage floor. So this is about 1 milliamp. So basically during this 20 seconds in between when it hears the white noise and when it receives the foot shock, the animal only learns that the white noise predicts the foot shock if it maintains some representation cognitively of the CS during this trace interval. And so the question was whether the prelimbic region in the prefrontal cortex might be encoding, maintaining in working memory that white noise CS. So to get at that, we perform silencing either during specifically that trace interval or at some time point a little bit following the trace interval. Everybody clear on the experiment then? Okay, and so all the animals, all the different controls, they learned, essentially they started freezing during conditioning itself. After 6 trials, they were freezing a lot, regardless of whether we played the CS or not. And so 6 trials are known, after 6 trials, 6 pairings of white noise and foot shock, the animal, you know, goes back and is brought back the next day. And now we test the animals, one, back in the original context, in which case all the animals displayed freezing when they went back to that original shock chamber. But now in a new context, only the animal, so normal condition control animals, they freeze when you play the white noise. So essentially they're now conditioned to the white noise stimulus as well. But the animals where there were their prefrontal cortex, prelimbic, was silenced during that trace interval, they displayed no freezing, essentially very little freezing to the white noise stimulus, indicating they were not afraid of the white noise. So they did not learn this prediction between the white noise and the shock when they're... So essentially, this allowed us to conclude that basically the prelimbic region in the prefrontal cortex is necessary for bridging that gap between the CS and the US, the shock.